lights proclaim the power and might of his great name. Let us exalt on bended knee. Praise God the Holy Trinity. Praise God.
Well, good morning and welcome to Desert Grace. Those of you that are streaming with us, be sure you let us know that you're streaming and mark how many folks are with you. So let's just take a couple minutes and greet everyone. So let's greet.
Good to see you.
Earlier this year,
I walked the halls of my high school
for the last time.
I went to my last college lecture.
I saw some of my classmates and teachers
for the very last time,
and I didn't even know it.
I had so many expectations of what was to come.
Senior breakfast.
Prom.
That feeling when you finish the last exam.
Being the first person in my family
to get handed a college diploma.
Walking across the stage.
All eyes on me.
Good luck hugs.
And final waves goodbye.
Supposed to be my time.
My time.
My time.
My time.
A celebration of hard journeys and sweet victories.
Proof that I didn't quit.
But in a blink of an eye,
everything changed.
And despite celebrations lost,
victories not received,
honors not given,
I'm taking something with me.
Not something taught in class,
but something taught
in life.
I can do all things.
All things.
All things.
I can do all things through Christ,
who gives me strength.
But it's not just about me.
There's still some people I have to thank.
Because no one crosses the finish line alone.
I want to thank my parents for believing in me no matter what.
And reminding me every day that I can do anything I set my mind to.
For praying for me every day and pushing me.
I want to thank my coach for convincing me that I can do anything.
I want to thank my professors for helping prepare me for God's plan for my life.
It's for helping me stay confident.
You helped me stand strong even when I didn't think I could.
I want to thank my choir and drama teachers for showing me how to use my talents in a way that honors God.
I want to thank my parents for helping me fulfill my dreams.
And told me the truth, even when I didn't want to hear it.
I want to thank all of my teachers
for going above and beyond to help me succeed.
Showed me how to embrace creative thinking.
Hopeful living.
I want to thank my small group leaders.
You pointed me toward God.
For I will stand in His strength.
I'll step out with grace over grief.
With courage over fear.
I will love God.
I will love others.
And I will make my mark in this world.
I'll make my mark in this world.
And I will make my mark in this world.
I am a graduate.
A couple of things. Life is, it's certainly not back to normal, but it's getting back toward normal for those of you who are interested in worshiping in person. We are implementing a new policy. There's going to be some information on our website as this week goes about, but basically I'm trying to make sure that social distancing is still in effect. For those that are already in here, they can attest to you that the chairs are in groupings and they're quite a ways apart. And there's some other things, and I would just invite you, if you have questions about that, to visit the website, not today, maybe tomorrow afternoon, and get all the latest information. We'll also update Facebook for you as well. But some things will be like one-way traffic. Please come in as a family. And I do want you to know that we never quit having church. We've been continuing to live stream. So on that note, we still want to be able to do everything that we were previously able to do. So I know that we have Asia Oviedo, who's getting ready to graduate this year, and I don't know of others, but maybe they're out there. And we want to find ways to make sure we're reaching out and supporting. We want to continue to be supportive of those of you who don't quite feel comfortable yet to come down to the church. To that end, by the way, the church board is investing in additional equipment for the live stream. So even as people are feeling more comfortable to come and worship in person, we are going to continue to improve what we're doing over there. With that being said, if you want to help pay for it, we could sure use your support, your tithes, your offerings. I know so many people have been giving online. They've been mailing it in. People here in person have been dropping it off. Lots of ways to do it. And if you'd like to support the extra expense, we've committed over $1,800 right now to improve the live stream. So any extra giving for that would be surely appreciated as well. It's a different time, but the church is going to persevere, and God is in control. So thank you so much for your faithful support. Heavenly Father, as we go to this time of offering, we recognize that what we do first and foremost in these moments is worship who you are and what you have done for us. That you have first provided resources for us, and now we give out of obedience back to you. Lord, for anyone who might be feeling led to give a little extra, we thank you for that. And we just ask that you would continue to provide exactly what's needed so that we can continue to minister not only to those who have already called Desert Grace their home, but to many far and near, well into the future. In your name we pray. Amen.
Just take him at his word, just to
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. Oh, for grace to trust Him more. Trust Him more.
You trust Him today?
Amen.
You know, everything looks like it's coming down, but we always can depend on Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Sorry about that. I am a spicy disaster at all times. As you guys know, the church took on quizzing last year, so this is making our second year, and we did not let COVID-19 stop us. It was a change up, and the kids got us some disappointments, but they rallied and they did an amazing job, and we'd like to celebrate their victories. They started doing quizzing online, so they didn't get to go to Las Vegas, but they still did just an incredible job, and I have some awards to give them. So hold on a second. All right. Oh, and this is all online, and here I am just a mess. Well, Kristen's not here, so Kristen, if you're watching, congratulations. I'll drop your awards off at home. I need Maddie. Maddie is our youngest quizzer, and normally she should be in the red group, but because you can quiz as an individual or a team, she came up to the blue team for the older kids so that we could try to compete as a blue team. Maddie, you did awesome, Saucy. You have received participation award, which is a huge deal for her age group, and you've received 2 bronze ribbons. Congratulations, Maddie. Good job. Thank you. I need an Emma. Emma, oh my goodness. This girl works so hard and is so incredible, and I'm so just proud of you. We're celebrating 3 quiz meets right now. In the first quiz meet that we missed, which was Las Vegas, and they had to do it online, so it was all new and all different. This girl got 2 perfect rounds out of 3. And she got another silver for the district final. Congratulations, Emma. You are incredible. Thank you. Up next, we have Mr. Lucas. This guy is my tech guy. He is always willing to jump in and help, even if you don't ask. But you gotta love him for it. You gotta love him. Lucas, in the Las Vegas quiz we meet, got 2 perfect rounds?
One.
It gets confusing. I don't understand how they handle this every time we go. It's crazy. So Lucas got perfect round, perfect round, perfect round. Lucas did so amazing in all these quizzes, he got to go to the region. Again, amazing, Lucas. You're incredible. Thank you. Aiden. Where are you, Aiden? Oh, he's working the camera. I won't move around too much, I promise. Aiden, just like his brother, did awesome, Saucy. Perfect round, perfect round, perfect round. He's got silver awards in there, medal ribbons in there, gold. He's incredible. He also got to go to the region quizzing. Congratulations. Thank you. I need Lucas and Aiden back up here. I need you back up here. I am so excited, I am bursting. I got an email first thing this morning with the results. Normally, they get to go to Point Loma and do this, but because of COVID, we had to do it online. And it takes some of the fun out of everything, a lot of the fun out of everything. But these guys persevered, and they did such an awesome job. They got to be placed on another team called the All-Stars, and their team, with their help, placed third. Amazing. I'm so proud and so excited for you guys. All my kids out there, the things you guys are doing for Christ in the name of the Lord, just, you're blowing me away. You guys are examples to everyone what is possible when you believe. Thank you.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah.
Awesome.
stone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace.
In prayer, I invite you to take whatever position of prayer is most comfortable to you. Those of you at home, just turning around at your kitchen table or your chair or even on your bedside, great place to just connect with God. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to worship you this morning. Lord, even when we are separated physically, we are together in spirit, and you are the one who has gathered us together for this moment in time. Lord, we just love you so much because you first showed your love to us and made it possible for us to be connected to you. We thank you that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for us. And Lord, we just ask that we would not forget this fact even when we go about our everyday mundane lives, that we would consistently be thinking about what you've done for us and offering ourselves back in response to what you have done for us. Heavenly Father, it's a gorgeous day. It's been a gorgeous week. We enjoy our connections with people, whether we get to see them face to face or see them online or using phones or whatever. We just thank you so much for the world you've created. But we especially thank you for the opportunity that it is to come into the very throne room of the Creator of the universe, the one who created everything that we see and everything that we are. And this morning, Lord, we enter that room together. We see you seated on the throne, and we recognize that we can ask the most powerful being in the universe anything that we want. Heavenly Father, as a congregation, we just come to you and continue to ask your hand on the national health crisis, really the worldwide health crisis. Lord, as things are opening back up, we continue to need your protection. We continue to need you to reach into the bodies of those who are afflicted and to continue to bring healing. But we also recognize that that's not the only thing going on in our world, that there are some that we're aware of today that so desperately need your touch as well. I think this morning specifically of Jim Oakley and some of the appointments that he's been traveling to and going through. And Lord, we just ask that they would all come out with some answers, and that Jim and Sherry would be comforted by your love. They'd be comforted with the knowledge of how these tests and these appointments come out, and that they would be on the right path for you to bring healing to Jim's body. We just thank you so much for both of them, Lord, and we just ask that you would continue to keep them safe, that you'd continue to guide them, and that you'd bring them back safely this coming winter. Lord, we have so many others we think of each week. We think of Alan and his lungs. We think of Janice Merritt and all of the things that she's been going through, Shirley Morgan. There are so many needs represented in our congregation alone. You know each and every one of them. And Lord, we just ask that you'd be with them. Lord, we ask that you'd be with all the other needs that are represented. Anyone who's struggling with finances, Lord, may you be the one who they depend on. Anybody who needs to fix a relationship in these difficult times, this would be the time for them to reach out and do so. Lord, be with them and give them guidance. And Lord, we just ask that you would continue to make us and mold us into the kind of church you want us to be. One where people are interested in knowing more about you. One where people are drawn to you. And one where people don't say, there's a bunch of hypocrites over there. Say one thing on Sunday and live another way the rest of the week. But one where people say, people walk into that place and they come out truly transformed. That's our prayer this morning, Lord, that we would not leave this place this morning the same as we walked in, but we will have leave this place having taken one step closer to you. Your name we pray. Amen.
Listen to those medals.
Thank you.
Our worship team does a really good job. And I know that those at home are just praising God. I mean, I've said it before, I'm sure you guys are just jumping up and down, and you know, if you lived on a second floor and there were people living on the first floor, you'd probably annoy them, and that's awesome. Yep.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter if you're just sitting there quietly. I want to believe what I want to believe. And as I've said more than once, when you're really excited about the sermon at home, you can just shout like your favorite football team just scored a touchdown and the neighbors want to know what you're watching, okay?
Amen.
Let's start off our morning talking a little bit about how a caterpillar transforms into a butterfly through the process of metamorphosis. That's exciting stuff, right? It's important that we sort of pay a little bit of attention to this, because hey, if we're really going to think about what God has done, the caterpillar is kind of a very interesting creature, because it's one creature but really sort of comes out in two different ways. And as a young creature, it is a caterpillar, and by the time it becomes an adult, it's a butterfly or a moth, but that's beside the point. lives as a caterpillar from anywhere from 4 weeks to many years. I guess the record is roughly 14 years. There's a species or two that really last a long time, but that generally it's about a month or two or three or four that the caterpillar lives as a caterpillar, and then it moves on and becomes something else. Creates that little silk chrysalis, I think it's pronounced, and then it takes roughly 2 weeks to be transformed into a beautiful butterfly. It's amazing to think about how that happens, and you think, all right, this thing with 12 eyes and all these legs crawling around suddenly becomes a butterfly. And that it happens all sort of intentionally. Now, the butterfly's lifespan, typically, it's about a week or two. So the poor thing lives its entire life to give a couple weeks of absolute beauty and to lay eggs so that there can be more caterpillars and more butterflies and the cycle shall continue. That's basically how it works. But here's the thing I find the most fascinating, that while the caterpillar is in its chrysalis, only the nerves of the caterpillar are not transformed. That every other part begins to basically become new. In fact, scientists describe it as sort of a soup. That in a sense, the caterpillar begins to be affected, and there is this soup out of which the only thing that remains of the original caterpillar is the nerves. And everything else becomes that butterfly. So when you see the caterpillar becoming that butterfly, emerging as a butterfly, it has truly been transformed. It's not that the caterpillar just suddenly grew wings. I think there's some children's books that are sort of along those lines. But it's that the caterpillar has been completely changed. That's important for us. We've been talking a little bit about church revolution, and I think one of the problems is that when we start talking about the church, and we know that the church has some flaws, I think we could agree with that, and as much as I hate to admit it, the reason why the church is flawed is because it is made of human beings, and some of you aren't perfect like me. Wait, I might have said that wrong. None of us are perfect. And so we become an imperfect organization because we are made of imperfect people. And so when we begin to look at the church, I don't want to say that everything we've been doing is wrong, but I will say this is sort of a little asterisk. In the last 8 weeks, we have learned that we could do things so much better. And I don't talk about this church, I talk about the church. And that God has given us some incredible tools in which we can use, and we should be taking better advantage of. I think it's important that we realize that church revolution isn't about tools, technology. It isn't about becoming perfect. It's about being transformed as God wants us to be transformed. That's what it really is all about. Now remember that a church revolution is not an uprising. Those that don't last very long. It's truly something to really make a difference. It's a calling. We talked a little bit about that last week, that God has a call on all of our lives. We've talked a little bit about some of the prerequisites and essentially that the call and some of the things we've discussed, you got to stop thinking about it and begin to do it. Question for today, what must be transformed in us so that we will become living sacrifices to God? And in so doing, we would be the kind of people who truly enact a revolution within the church that takes the church from simply being a place of social club or a place of apathy to a place that really impacts the world around us. What must we do? The Apostle Paul wrote to the Romans about an important part of participating in church revolution. He didn't use quite those words, but I think it's what he meant. That if we're not careful, we fall into the less important parts of the church and forget what we're truly supposed to be doing. that we get into the business, meaning the making the church happen, and forget the whole reason why we're doing it. I have a feeling that's part of what he was really getting after when he wrote to the Romans. But there's two verses that I want to concentrate on today, and it's your lucky day. I had 12 pages written, but I shortened them down to 11. Just kidding. Normally there's 6 to 7. I stuck with that. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. It's kind of nice of the Apostle Paul to go easy on us in those couple of verses and just say, hey, look, the Christian walk is going to be simple. You get to come in as you were and you get to leave as you were. Wait. I think sometimes we wish that's what he said. Paul is urging, and what he's urging his readers to do is to say, look, what God has done for you, you have a response. And your response is to give yourself back, essentially to sacrifice yourself to God, but not in the sense of a human sacrifice. We're going to put you on the altar and let you out of your misery. But in a sense of really, truly becoming an instrument of who God is. We're going to kind of come back to that in a moment. Paul begins the talking to the Romans, and he's laying out this really extensive theology. If you really want to get mired down in the theology of who Jesus is and how God works, go ahead and open up Romans and start reading. It's deep, deep, deep stuff. I mean, it's great stuff. Don't get me wrong. It's deep stuff. It's how you can take two verses and go, all right, I only have, you know, like 40 minutes before people really all fall asleep. And there's so much more, so deep, so rich. So he really begins to talk about what Jesus has done. He gets into this idea that Jesus is a sacrifice, and he goes through all of this, and finally he gets to chapter 12, and the first word in chapter 12, I know you've got it in front of you, I know that you're doing it, but it's therefore. And we know whenever you see the word therefore, you must find out what it's. You've got to say, all right, something before this makes a big difference. And Paul says, look, everything that God has done for you, therefore you offer yourself as a living sacrifice to God. It's like saying, gee, I really, really, really love lemon pie or lemon cupcakes. Sees lemon truffles. You're following this, right? Therefore, when my birthday comes, or if you just want to say, Pastor, I love you so much, anything with lemon except the lemon itself is pretty good. You see what the therefore is there for a reason. And Paul is saying, look at what God has done for you. Now, therefore, here you do something for God back. It's your natural response. And Paul isn't like demanding, although he sort of is commanding. He's not saying, because I am the Apostle Paul, this is what you must do. Instead, what he's basically saying is that because of what God has done for you, and God in his mercy has done for you, then you ought to be doing this. That's the bottom line. That's how it works. The activity of us as Christians, because we are living sacrifices, ought to be guided by a very specific ethic. When we think of ethic, we have all kinds of words. There's a work ethic. How much do we work? How hard do we work? How much do we work toward what God wants us to do? Or we might say it's important to have good ethics and make sure that you're always being honest and having integrity and so forth like that. But part of what Paul is saying is that you should be guided by a specific way of living because you are a living sacrifice to God. In fact, if you were to continue reading, please don't do so now, I'm preaching. But if you were to continue to read after verse 2, what you're going to find is that Paul is beginning to give you a lot of ways in which this living sacrifice works its way out. For example, you should be humble, considering others as maybe a little higher than yourself. Don't think too highly of yourself, he says. That you need to be loving, and if you're going to hate anything, hate what God hates. He's going to talk about you need to honor people. He's going to talk about you need to be zealous. You understand what that means, right? It's kind of the same as apathy if we were going to take what the church says seriously. Because when we talk about, hey, you should be important, most Christians seem to be a little bit apathetic anymore. We need to be careful about that because Paul's saying we should be living as a sacrifice. Zealous means we approach everything like, all right, we are going to take over the world with love, humility, honoring people. Love how one of the ethics that he mentions, and by the way, this could have gone on all day, but I'm gonna let you off after joyful. Which incidentally doesn't mean the same thing as happy. It means peaceful. That's the ethic that having a living being a living sacrifice will be a part of. Here's the thing about ethics and what drives you. Ethics, whatever your ethics are made of, will guide every single decision that you make. Now, I want to be real clear here, because sometimes really good people make really dumb mistakes. Really good people make one mistake, and sometimes we then want to nail them to the wall for it for the rest of their lives. I think we got to be careful about that, but your ethics will guide every decision that you make. And that is something that's absolutely essential. One of the things Paul really wants to get to us is that the ethic of a Christ follower should be to the benefit of the entire community. When you begin to look at what he's saying, when he talks about being humble, not considering yourselves more highly than you ought to, and considering others as important, and honoring others, these are community sorts of things. It's not merely, you know, just do this for yourself or the people that you have to live with or whatever else. He's saying that this is something that is going to benefit the community. And in fact, he begins this, therefore, my brothers and sisters, my family in Christ, we're family because we are all adopted by God. We are engrafted branches in God's family. So guess what? If you believe in Jesus Christ, you and me, we're brother and sister, whether we like it or not. I could tell a story there, but I'll stop. In fact, this very act of offering yourself as a sacrifice is something that, yes, is a very personal decision, and it's something you must do for yourself, but it is also something that we do as a community, that we do as we begin to show one another and be challenged by one another to live within the ethic that we have defined. In fact, we have a little thing in the bulletin that says membership class, and if you're not a member, essentially becoming a member is all about saying, I agree with the ethic of the Church of the Nazarene and want to be a part of it. Agree to live by that particular ethic. And by the way, just as sort of a sideline to that, we have some really important things that we make you agree to, like Jesus is Savior. Kind of an ethic we live by. Anyway, when you live as a member of the Christian community, you affect everyone else in the community. You're going to affect them positively or you're going to affect them negatively. That's kind of up to how seriously you take this sacrifice. And part of the problem of the living sacrifice, you might have heard this before, living sacrifices tend to try to crawl off the altar. That's the reality, and we find ourselves doing that. The act of sacrifice is really to make yourself completely and totally available to God. And now, there's two words there that I made sure to use both of them. One is completely. And in case you didn't know what that means, it means completely. The other one is for clarity. First, you have completely, and when you're done with that, you also do it totally. And in case you don't know what that means, it means totally. And those two words put together mean that when you have done this, when you are available to God completely and totally, it means that you will do whatever God asks. You will follow God wherever He asks you to go. You will do whatever God wants you to do. You won't necessarily always be super excited about it. But your first concern is going to be to God. Which means that if God says, hey, let me tap you on the shoulder and I have a plan for you. I'm going to send you as a missionary to this far off country. And you've already told God, I'm completely and totally available to you as an instrument of your will. You have to say, all right, I guess I'm learning whatever language that happens to be. Or I guess I'm going to wherever that is. That's what totally and completely means. It means that we become completely an instrument of God, regardless of anything else that we wish that we were or that we desire to be. In a sense, it says, I take what I want out and I give it to God. Now, I put little asterisks in here, okay, because I've noticed that a lot of times God lets me do the very things that I enjoy. Now, I wouldn't have said that like years ago when God first said, hey, why don't you become a preacher? I would have said, you know, getting in front of people is not my thing. What do you do with that? If God calls you and you have said whatever it takes, what do you do? You see, it's more than just a spiritual exercise and going, okay, God, I'm here for you. You can have all of me as long as you only stick to the spiritual side. Or that it's just something that we use logic with and okay, God, you can have all of me so long as it makes sense to me. Because let me tell you something, the minute you become an instrument of God completely and totally, that you are a living sacrifice, God is going to ask you to do the most outlandish thing you ever imagined. Some of you have already been through it, I think. If you haven't, hold on. Hold on. This is the response to God for bringing us from darkness to light, from death to life. Our response is to say, okay, God, because you have done this for me, I will give my all to you. Paul describes three very specific aspects of this sacrifice. The first thing is that it ought to be living. It ought to be living. I've been around the church long enough to see some dead sacrifices in the pews. Not pointing any fingers today. If you think I'm aiming at you, I'm not. I'm just telling you. I've been around some really dead sacrifices. Dead because all they really are concerned about is themselves. A couple things I want to mention. Jesus paid the final price, so we don't need to be doing the whole sacrifice thing. If Jesus has already defeated sin and already paid the price for sin, and by uniting with him, we no longer have to worry about it, then that is done. It's final. And when Jesus came on the scene, it was still a time where blood sacrifices, animal sacrifices were given in order to get forgiveness of sins. We don't do that anymore, thank God. But why not? Because of Jesus. So we aren't dead sacrifices. We don't vote somebody every year to be our human sacrifice into the volcano. We give ourselves, I've got some people, never mind. We give ourselves as living sacrifices. Amen. Yep. What this ultimately becomes is you and I, as followers of Christ, we must decide what we're going to live for or for whom we are going to live. And the bottom line is, it ought to be beyond us. You see, it's super easy to be very self-centered because we know exactly what we want. Try to figure God out. It seems a little harder, I think, sometimes. But God asks us to. I've thought about this, that when we begin to allow ourselves to be reallocated to God's purpose and God's person alone, we really are truly living. When we're concerned about our dreams, our desires, our whatever, it's not really that much life. Because if that's the case, in times like these, you are struggling. Because there is no evidence, or there is no comfort when the enemy is something like a virus that you cannot see, you cannot touch, and you know, avoid. But that instead, it is something that is invisible. But knowing that God is in control is living in the deepest sense of living. So not only should it be a living sacrifice, the second thing is it should be holy. Now, what exactly does that mean? What exactly does it mean to be holy? I think holiness at its very core is being set aside for God's purposes, for the purposes of righteous and not the purposes of evil, that God consecrates us and cleanses us so that we can be his instruments, his living sacrifices into the world. And so God gives us this opportunity. And so if we are set apart for God's purposes as living sacrifices, we are on the right track. We are doing what we're supposed to be doing. You see, there is a sense at which God created us, and therefore we belong to us. God created us, and therefore we belong to God. I want to be my own. But I look around and I see the blessings and I know they're not from me. That when God creates us, he creates us with a very specific purpose in mind. When we have that purpose in mind, we are living truly into what God wants us to do. So we become his. If we are God's property, we should probably be more concerned with what he wants from us than what we want for us. And I got to tell you a little secret here. Don't tell anyone else. It's between us, okay? I would tell Austin to stop the stream, but it's all right. No one's watching anyway. And if they are, they'll keep the secret. When you give up what you want and you do what God wants, and live the way God wants you to live, you will actually enjoy your life more than you ever have before. Amen. It's a serious weirdness, right? It's like living sacrifices. It's an oxymoron. That if you'll give up who you think you ought to be and let God be the dictator, he does a better job. Amen. Whoa, that was weird. Make sure I didn't miss anything. When we give ourselves as a sacrifice, it should be a once-and-for-all decision. That in a sense, God makes us holy in that moment. And if we do our best not to crawl off the altar and walk away from Him, it's not something that we have to deal with every single day. I just kind of want to point that out. The third thing your living sacrifice ought to be is it should be pleasing to God. In other words, it's going to satisfy what God wanted from you. It's going to satisfy what God expects from you, not just what you're willing to give. Here's the problem with that. You probably have figured this out before. If you've been walking with God for a while, you've experienced this, where you want to do what God wants you to do, but God wants you to do something really radical. Super radical. Or at least it seems really radical in the moment. Sometimes it's like, well, why do I feel like I ought to do this? And when you do it, God is pleased. And when God is pleased, you are happy. It's God's. It's what He's supposed to do. And when we begin to recognize that God wants us in our complete and full worship to be an all-day, every-day, every-moment affair, we will get this right. God's expectations is that we are going to live for Him, that we are going to not just worship when we come into this building, but we will worship in our lives as living sacrifices. Amen. So when I say, well, you know, worship was wonderful this morning. It was great. It was just when we get recentered and get ready for another week of worshiping. Because what God wants us to do is recognize that the very best worship that we could ever give Him is to live for Him under His control. Cultic worship, which is the term for what we do in church. It's honestly the truth. It's not enough. If you are either watching this on YouTube or Facebook or you physically are here in person and you say, there you go, I've given my hour and a half, I've worshiped this week. God's going, You barely started, my friend. If you really want to please God, worship is something that you do every day. It's more than just singing some songs or listening to a sermon. In fact, worship is way more than that. It's how we live our lives. It's what we do. It's how we make things happen. And therefore, we need to be doing everything that we can in order to make sure that we are pleasing God and not ourselves. It's essential. Worship for us is in a sense of service, not of church service. Of our being an instrument to God. It's a decision not merely to just comply with God, what God is calling us. It's to embrace it with everything that we are. Because when we don't, we're simply going through the motions as though that's what God has asked us to do. But what God is truly asking us to do is to respond to what He has done for us. I hate to say this out loud, but I'm going to do it anyway. Worship that just looks for a feeling, that we would be presented with a particular feeling in our heart or in our mind or in our soul, is not worship that is pleasing to God unless we get that feeling from giving our entire lives to God. So, I guess part of what I'm trying to say there is if you ever walk away from church and go, well, I guess today was kind of a bummer, not a very good worship service, I didn't even feel the Holy Spirit, it's on you, not on Him. And good news is you have the whole rest of the week. Paul is challenging us as Christ followers, be known for active, living, everyday life worship. That's what Paul is calling us to do. That's what he seeks for us to be. True worship is agreement with God's will, with God's purpose, and with God's call on one's life. Don't get this wrong. If you are truly going to be worshiping, you have to be in agreement with God's will, with God's purpose, and with God's call on your life. And in order to do that, it's just so easy. You gotta let God be in the driver's seat. Nothing else is going to work. And that worship finds its fulfillment in how we act, in our ethic. You see what Paul's getting at? That if we will become these sorts of people, we will live out what God has called us to do. This sort of worship, it overlaps the sacred. It overlaps the secular. You won't know whether you're in church or not because everywhere you are, you're going to be doing the same ethic. It's good stuff. People at home are shouting. Their neighbors want to know what's going on. Paul wants us to be transformed rather than to be conformed. The scripture says it's something like, the NIV anyway, says it's something like this: do not conform to the world, but be transformed. The Greek goes more into the do not be conformed, but be transformed. Because here's the thing. We tend to be conformers. We tend to respond to influences that are around us. It's a community reality. In that we, as those of us that live here in Yuma, live like Yuma expects humans to live. Not the government, but the people. There's a particular feeling in this community, and if you go to any community anywhere, there's going to be a particular feeling about that community. There's a certain thing that people do, and people expect you to have respect for, and all of those sorts of things. You are going to conform to influences around you. That's just the reality of it. And if you are around people at work or at school or wherever you happen to be, you will become more like those people because they exert a force of conforming on top of you. And Paul's saying, be careful about how you are impacted by others. Be careful about whose expectations you find most important. Be careful about all these things. In fact, what he's telling you is essentially that as you give yourself as a living sacrifice, resist the forces of the world and cooperate with the forces that are sort of conforming you or transforming you into new. Resist one. The bottom line is this: you can't be holy alone. You can't. Holiness is only experienced in community. You can only be set apart as part of a community that is set apart from the world. Otherwise, you're likely to either just be crazy or more conformed to the world than you are to the things of God. You see, the inner transformation that we go through as living sacrifices, being transformed into new life, it results in an outward witness. Think of the butterfly. A complete change, and the outward witness is beauty. Caterpillars, they're kind of cool to look at, maybe. But butterflies, people love them. The purpose of a renewed mind is to recognize God's good, perfect will. So you're looking at the second half of verse 2 here. I told you there was a lot of really good stuff here. There's a lot more I want to say. My time is running short already. Paul says, do not be transformed, or do not be conformed, but be transformed, and then you will know. This is the then. That if you are allowing your renewed mind to be transformed, you will begin to recognize God's good, perfect will. And just so we're all clear on this, this is an always evolving thing. You get closer to God, God's desire for you gets clearer to you. And as you continue to offer yourself as a living sacrifice, we said, living, holy, pleasing to God, you will more and more be able to see what God wants for you. That's the reality. By the way, this is where freedom in Christ comes from. When you begin to understand what God wants for your life in every aspect of your life, the law becomes unnecessary because you want to live as God wants you to live. So rather than needing a bunch of boundaries to make sure you don't go away from God, there's freedom there. The transformation proves itself in everyday experience. It's demonstrated through your daily life. There's an important question there for you. I won't ask it and ask you to answer it, but the question is, what does your life prove? Now, I'm not talking about the fact that you're in church. Okay, good for you. But come about Tuesday afternoon, what will people think? Next Saturday morning, what are people going to think? Next Sunday morning, as you're getting ready for church, how cranky are you? When you are within God's will, you will demonstrate that by your life, what is good, pleasing, and perfect. Got what I'm saying? Yep. Get what Paul's saying? I'm telling you, I could preach on this a whole nother hour. What must be transformed for us to become a living sacrifice to God? This is a question I asked you earlier. You already know the answers. You can just fill in your blanks. I could stop. Okay, I'll keep going. We must transform the way we think in order to become a living sacrifice. We have to change the very way we use our minds if we're really going to be a living sacrifice. And I got to thinking about this, and I said, you know what? My guess is that if I say this, some of you are going to be sitting there going, okay, how do I do that? How do I change the way I think? It's what you're thinking, isn't it? I'm going to give you a real quick answer. Well, it's not. It's really a really long answer. But we best transform our thinking when we are active readers of the Scripture. See how simple it is? That God has provided us an entire book of His history. And if you want to think more like God, you ought to know how God thinks. And the more you read that book, the more you understand how God thinks, the more you realize that what God wants is for you to be close to Him, not to wander away. The more you realize that He wants you not to be going around being mean to other people, that He wants you to love everybody and hate evil. You want to change the way you think? Be an active reader of Scripture. Oh, it's that easy, is it? I think also that we transform our thinking when we are active in learning communities in the church. Now, reading Scripture is plenty good, but if you're anything like me, you can't just read Scripture and go, oh, I get it. Look, you all pay me to give these speeches every single week. And this just doesn't come from my brilliance. Like, God doesn't just go, whoosh. I study, I read books, I have resources, I sometimes watch somebody else's sermon, I do all these different things. And I, too, am part of an active learning community. And sometimes when we are, like, in Wednesday night studies, when people are asking questions and talking and giving points, guess who else is learning? Me! And part of the problem is if you just read Scripture yourself, you can read it and have a totally wrong idea of who God is. You see, the ultimate transformation comes when we truly allow God, Jesus, really, to transform our minds, to become more like Him. What's driving your thinking today? Is Jesus' example, which you will find in the Scriptures, at the forefront? Second thing, we must transform the way we pray if we are going to become a living sacrifice. And I'm cheating a little bit here, because this is also part of how we think, right? Not only do we go into Scripture, but we got to change the way we pray. And I think one of the problems is simply this. It's too often that we go into prayer and we are just doing all of the talking. And so often we are bringing God a laundry list of issues. And if you're anything like me, you sometimes find yourself in sort of this time crunch. Ooh, I need to talk to God about these things. And so you say, oh, Lord, do this, this, and this, and I need to know about this. Okay, goodbye. Well, I say amen, but, oh, you know. If we are going to be active, if we're going to be true sacrifices, prayer needs to be including us listening to what God has to say to us. And what does that mean to us? Can I say it just bluntly a little bit? Shut up! When you're talking to God, shut up and listen to what He has to say to you. We aren't good with silence. Sometimes I'm on the Zoom call on Wednesday night and I'll ask a question and like everyone's like just sitting there staring back into their screens. And like when people are in person, you know, I don't have to worry about it. But literally in the Zoom class, sometimes I'm wondering if the internet froze. No one's moving. No one's saying anything. And then I say, hey, did my internet just freeze? I didn't hear anything. And then they laugh. Ha, 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 ha. We're afraid of silence. Prayer is also a very significant investment. But I want to kind of point something out here. I think sometimes what the church has done is it's sort of made it out to be, all right, you need to make an appointment with God first thing in the day. You don't want to start your day without some prayer. So you got to make an appointment with God, wake up at least an hour early, and spend an hour with God. Let me tell you how that would work for me, because I've tried it. Dear Lord, I'm here to spend some... It's exactly how that ends. I also will point it out in a little more personal way. My wife spends her week up in Chandler, right? If I were to say, hon, tomorrow morning I am going to call you an hour early and we can just talk for an hour before you go to work. How would that work? Now, she's bright and perky in the morning. I'm usually awake 3 hours after I get up. I probably wouldn't fall asleep. She's got a really nice voice. Kind of makes me get warm feelings inside. And a couple times, for whatever reason, we have talked, and I haven't fallen asleep on her yet. But what happens when she has to go to work? This does happen kind of frequently. She's like, I got a meeting. Like, yeah, well, you know what? This, 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 and this. Okay, I got a meeting. No, no, this, this, and this. Oh, no, no, I got a meeting. Do you think sometimes we do that to God? Hey, got a meeting. Not that she should be worried about me. But if we try to mix it in to an hour in one sitting. So how does life really work? You wake up, you say things like, good morning. How'd you sleep? I don't know how you replace that with what you say to God. Maybe you say, God, thank you. I got some great sleep last night. You're going to have to explain that one dream to me. But other than that, can you talk to God while you're fixing breakfast? I've been real clear on this. You're more than welcome to pray in the car. It's a great time to pray. Don't close your eyes. There might be a policy against, like, your workplace, you know, if you were to say, I got to go pray. But what if you're sitting at your desk and you start praying? Start having a conversation with God. I'll tell you this, God is everywhere, right? So if you expect during your hour-long devotional in the morning that God is going to say all he has to say to you only during your appointment, good luck with that. God's going to know right when to hit you with what he wants to hit you with. And he doesn't care if you're at work. He doesn't care if you're taking a shower. Has your prayer life been transformed the way God wants you to transform it? We must transform the way we church to become a living sacrifice, and by the way, to be part of church revolution. If nothing else has been proven in the last 8 weeks, we have proven that the church is not the building and it's not limited to what can happen in this place. It's not. And we need to be careful about that. You see, how we think about church is going to be key to how we respond and how much we are active in church revolution. It's not a building. It's not a program. It's a community of people who are worshipers, not just on Sunday morning and Wednesday night or whatever other time. It's a community of worshipers who live as God wants them to live. And these moments when we get together, do you know what they're great for? Having a little taste of heaven. People who love, people who don't hate, people who seek after God and worship together. We must evaluate our commitment to God's church. We need to be checking to see, are we giving God's church enough of our time, enough of our talent, enough of our finances or our other resources? Because if we're not, we got to fix it. We may need to transform the way we participate in church. I would suggest you ask yourself a couple questions. Why are you here? If you can't honestly answer that with, I'm here to worship God and to be challenged for the week and to be a part of this community, you got to come up with a better answer. If you're asking yourself, why do you participate? And if it is because the only reason you're here is because of something else, you got to challenge yourself to why does God want you here? You see, if we're really going to be the revolutionaries that God wants, we are going to have to go through some metamorphosis. It's going to be kind of a lifelong thing. Some of us have already started. But oh, how fun it'll be on the day when we're beautiful. You know what I mean? Inside and out. That's what church ought to be about. That's what real church ought to be promoting. What kind of sacrifice are you? Living? Dead? Are you holy? Are you pleasing to God? What kind of sacrifice are you? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you so much for your challenge. We thank you so much that you are the one who gives us the ability to do what we're supposed to do. And so, Lord, today we ask you to speak into each one of our lives, that you would guide us, that you would direct us, that you would take what we have talked about this morning and that you would absolutely make it a reality in our lives, that you would empower us to be your church the way you want your church to be. Because Heavenly Father, we want to be revolutionaries for you. We want to be living sacrifices. We want things the way you designed them. Open our eyes when our eyes need opened. Open our ears when our ears need to be hearing you. And help us not to be afraid of the silence, but help us to embrace the sweet, soft sound of your voice giving us your instructions. Heavenly Father, we love you, we thank you. Keep us safe until we have the opportunity to gather again and worship you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.
are good when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, when you have covered all my sins. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. Oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. Of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reigns. You are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, all creation. Of your love will always be enough. Nothing compared to your embrace. Light of the world forever reigns. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compared. Will sing no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing no other name, Jesus, Jesus.
God bless you.